Amen, amen, amen. Well, good morning, Macedonia. Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Sunday School on this glorious, glorious day, the first Sunday in August 2020. My God, who would have thought when we had to go away from our physical building in March that we would still be able to be here and not only be here, having an amazing time in the Word in the month of August. And so we are so thankful for each and every one of you. I'm going to ask the First Lady if you would mute your line because I can hear the echo now. Those of you who are joining on, we're believing we're going to have a great, great discussion for our lesson today. And so without further ado, let's get into it. I'm going to ask Trustee Dane and Reed if you'll pray us in, man, and then let's get started.
Absolutely. Good morning, everyone. Father, we thank you so much for another day. Thank you for waking us up in our right minds with activity in our bodies and bringing us together, Lord, to discuss this Sunday school lesson. We thank you, Lord, in advance for a great, great blessed day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Well, I was looking for a few more people on my panel, but you know what? God got the ones we supposed to have. So
Amen. Let's
get it. Let's get it. We have a very familiar, but I believe a very robust lesson today from the book of 1 Samuel chapter 13. And the name of our lesson today is Saul's Disobedience Under Pressure. Saul's Disobedience Under Pressure. And I'm going to ask First Lady, if you'll go ahead and read us our lesson in its entirety, please.
First Samuel 13, beginning at verse 5. Can you hear me? Amen. And the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel. 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude. And they came up and pitched in Michmash, eastward from Beth Aven. When the men of Israel saw that they were in a strait, for the people were distressed, then the people did hide themselves in caves and in thickets and in rocks and in high places and in pits. And some of the Hebrews went over Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. As for Saul, he was yet in Gilgal, and all the people followed him trembling. And he tarried 7 days, according to the set time that Samuel had appointed. But Samuel came not to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, "Bring hither a burnt offering to me, and peace offerings." And he offered the burnt offering. And it came to pass that as soon as he had made an end of offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. And Saul went out to meet him, that he might salute him. And Samuel said, "What hast thou done?" And Saul said, "Because I saw that the people were scattered from me, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together at Michmash," the Philistines, "therefore said I, the Philistines will come down now upon me to Gilgal, and I have not made supplication unto the Lord. I forced myself therefore and offered a burnt offering." And Samuel said to Saul, "Thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. But now thy kingdom shall not continue. The Lord hath sought him a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee."
Amen, amen, amen. Awesome, awesome, awesome. So, as we stated, a very familiar passage of scripture, a very familiar character in the Bible, Saul. We know that Saul is the first king of Israel. And in the last few lessons, we've talked about Samuel has been the common character, but We're introducing now Saul, not as the one following, trying to find some donkeys, but now him actually taking the throne and operating. And we're going to see how that worked out. And so once again, our lesson is called Saul's Disobedience Under Pressure. I wish I had time just to tabernacle right there, because pressure is one of those things that bring out the best in you and the worst in you. Many times there, and I've said it many, many times, Brother Dana, that there are at least two events that I know of that you will see the real in some people. And usually there's some pressure involved in it. You'll see the real in people at a wedding, and you'll see the real in people at a funeral. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. When the pressure is on, you'll see the real. And this thing called salvation and Christianity and walking after God's word, you can only fake it so long, and eventually the real will come out. So let's just get right into it. We got three outlines with today, and want to make sure that we get as much time in the discussion as possible. So the first outline is Saul and the people fear defeat. Saul and the people fear defeat. And that's verse number 5-7. And so the scripture tells us in verse number 5, as First Lady read, it says, "And the Philistines gathered themselves together to fight with Israel, 30,000 chariots, 6,000 horsemen, and people as the sand which is on the seashore in multitude, and they came up and pitched in Michmash, eastward from Beth Aven." And then it says, "When the men of Israel saw that, for the people were distressed, then the people did hide themselves in caves and in thickets and in rocks and in high places and in pits." Now, what we have is just a little bit of the backstory behind it. Then I'm gonna send it right over to the panelists and let them get rocking here this morning. What we have is that Saul has now he's actually been incarnated. I think that's the right word. He's been crowned. Stop trying to use big words. He's been crowned as king. And that's it right there. And so and what he did, the Amorites, a former enemy of Israel, came up against one of the cities, and Saul pulled the army together of 330,000 soldiers, 300,000 from Israel and 30,000 from Judah. He brought in an army that was very big, and he defeated the Amorites. So he's had military victory. After that military victory, his son Jonathan, then with an army of about 1,000 or so, went in and attacked a garrison of the Philistines and defeated them. Well, the Philistines hear about this. They now have built up their full strength of army response, but for two reasons. Well, yeah, at least two reasons. One, because Israel has chosen a king, and they took that as an act of war. And then two is because Jonathan, which Saul gets the credit for it, but Jonathan defeated one of their military outposts, one of their garrisons. And so now they've come up, and because of the military success early on, the Philistines now, they brought a major army. It says that they had 30,000 chariots and 6,000 horsemen, and the people as the sand which is on the sea. Now, let me just make sure we're all on the same page. Most theologians say that number of 30,000 is one of those biblical stretches, if you will, that number wasn't 30,000 chariots, because that's too many chariots for the horsemen. So you usually have the same number or about the same number of horsemen as you have chariots. So you got 30,000 chariots, but you only got 6,000 horsemen. As a matter of fact, you usually have 2 horsemen per chariot. So it's believed that that is actually a biblical misprint, that that number really was either 300 or 3,000. 300 or 3,000 chariots, but the horsemen number is accurate, but those who were with them, the foot soldiers, if you will, were so many, they didn't try to number them. They just said it's like the sand on the seashore. So it was a massive. Their arch enemies, the Philistines, had come back, and they came back with a major, major force. They got scared. And they didn't just get scared and do like some people just get scared and stand there. No, they got scared and they hid themselves. They started hiding in caves and in rocks and on hills and in high places and in pits of water, reservoirs of water that was stuck, if you will, located inside those many rocks. And so that's where we are right now for verse 5 and 6. Let me just hear from our panelists. What are you guys seeing? And what do you have to say to our students this morning?
Good morning, Pastor. Thank you so much for the invitation and the introduction into our scriptures on today. I don't want to go any further than the first one, 13:5, where it talks about how the Philistines actually gathered themselves together. And one of the things I'm seeing in scripture today is here it is. We have Samuel in his position. And at this point, Saul. Saul went out to meet him. But at this point, Samuel has already been positioned in his He's in his position for about 2 years. He looks like he's progressing in a good form. Everything seems to be going well. And then there seems to be a threat. So what amazes me is that when we are put in a position of either power and authority that may be looked at or perceived as a threat, the enemy will oftentimes do whatever it takes to pull out our stops to stop us. And that's exactly what happened in our scripture today. Right at 5, immediately, that's the response that we have is, okay, we're not just doing a little bit. We're going to go all out to make sure that this thing is not progressing, because now he's had not one, but 2 years of success. And this is not going to work for us. So we have to go in to shift things and actually not just defeat, but even create that fear by number. And I know you said the numbers may not be as accurate, but they did whatever they could because they knew they needed to do it in their strength in numbers. And so we can't, as humans, be shocked and surprised when the enemy comes at us with numbers, because the whole point is to throw us off our game. He wants to make sure that when we see it, that we get fearful, that it throws us out of our God game to where we can't even pay attention to what God is saying, but instead that we're looking and trying to figure it out in our own strength. And to me, that's exactly what we have right in 5, just in the beginning of 5. We have somebody already strategizing because they're watching from afar of the progress and what looks like a good thing is occurring. And now they're like, oh no, this is it. So that's the nugget I'm gonna put in on this section, and I'm gonna go ahead and handle it over to my other panelists.
All right, good morning. So what I think about when I read verse 5 is I kind of go back to Caleb and Joshua when they were asked to go and scout the land of the promised land, and just how they saw the giants. And so I'm relating the giants that were in that land to the number of chariot and charioteers in this particular scripture. So you're talking about whether it's the numerous size of an army or the physical appearance of your enemy being outnumbered or outsized. And so when they saw the giants in that particular land, of course that they became fearful, you know. So it's that perception of what you see that can distort your confidence. And Caleb and Joshua were the only two who had the courage to go forth and obey God's command. And then you had the other 10 who saw the giants and you know, lost their cool, lost their focus, lost that faith, that confidence. And so just going off what Minister Spicer said, just knowing that the enemy will put something that looks deceiving in front of you, you know, to kind of throw you off your square, because all it takes is a little bit of fear to knock you off your game plan. So just that idea that whatever, everything that you see, you know, may not be exactly what it appears to be. So.
Amen. Amen. Pastor. List said, I'm looking at what has gone on in the scripture, and it's clear in human, they have a king that's human, and he leads them in victory. And they thought that what worked for their neighbors would work for them. But what they didn't understand was they weren't walking in the same authority that their neighbors were walking in. So they shouldn't try to use the same battle methods that were working for their neighbors. They were walking under the authority of being led by the anointing of God and his judges. And so once they started going down the path of trying to be like their neighbors instead of being what God told them to be, their vision was getting distorted. And just as Brother Danon said, they were able to feel a fear that, just like Minister Spicer was saying, they had already experienced battle. And as you said, Pastor, they had already experienced victory. And even though they had experienced victory, what I'm looking at as application is we're always going to experience some victory as Christians. We're going to go in those, we're going to have spiritual warfare, and we're going to experience victory. And once we experience victory, then the next challenge is coming, and it's going to be bigger than whatever we already overcame. And it will be tempting for us to be afraid, but we need to remember that if God was with us in the last battle, and he was, and if we obey God and were victorious, then we need to trust God, even when it looks crazy in the next battle.
Amen, Pastor. Amen. Actually, I thought we were going to hit on this a little bit, and I know you probably can add to it, but I really wanted to acknowledge the fact that even though the people got fearful, they would go anywhere and do anything in that midst of fear. So really pushing that. And the fact that here it is, it says they went in thickets and rocks and high places and pits. They went to the land of Gad and all over. So it's amazing how when we're operating in fear, what we'll actually allow ourselves to succumb to. So I want to make sure we bring that out as well.
That's awesome, because I was going to ask the panel, I was saving just a question of, what do you guys think about when it says that they were fearful, they were in straits, they were fearful and they felt distressed. And then we get to verse 7, and then now they did cross over to cross the Jordan to the land of Gad and Gilead. And even the ones that were with Saul, they followed him, but they were trembling. They were trembling. Give our students a little more oomph, if you will, on that. You know, is it okay? Is it normal? Is it a lack of faith? What do you guys think when you see something like that? And knowing now, when you answer, know this, that the people don't want to just hear what's the biblical answer. They want to know what you do. So, all at us.
Amen, Pastor. Although the scripture is very clear that God does not give us a spirit of fear, so we're not supposed to walk like controlled by fear, I think it's impossible that we wouldn't feel fear as Christians. Because if we weren't going to feel fear, God wouldn't have to tell us in Joshua, fear not, be very courageous. Like he told Joshua over and over and over, don't be afraid, be courageous. So to me, just because we get afraid when we see fearful things That just means we're walking in flesh. That doesn't mean that we're not faithful. That doesn't mean that we've lost trust in God, but we got to do both. We got to be able to see the thing. If it's a scary thing, go ahead and admit, God, this is looking crazy and I need you. But then we have to keep walking. So what I love about these folks, yes, they trembled, but they followed him. They followed him while they trembled. They didn't all just go hide in caves and not follow him because they were scared. Some of them were scared and they still kept following. So to me, that's when your faith is putting some feet on it, when you can feel the fear and do it anyhow.
Amen. And notice that there was two different kinds. So we have to decide which one we're going to be. So in other words, no fear's coming. Oh, it can come. But will you remain in obedience at that time? And that separated the two. Some hid, some did some other things. Some said, I'm scared, but I'm going. Because that's who I'm supposed to follow. That's where I'm supposed to be. So the question is which one are you? Fear's going to come. Are you going to remain in obedience and follow the one that you're supposed to follow? Or are you going to move out of fear and it position you in a place you're not supposed to be? Amen. Thank you, First Lady.
Amen. Hey, Pastor, you muted, brother.
Yep, that's on purpose.
Got you. Good morning, everyone. For me, the application is a little bit of what King David did when he had all the adversity, where he had to be faithful enough to encourage himself in the Lord. Sometimes, hey, going into uncharted territory, uncharted waters, and you got all these obstacles coming against you, sometimes you have to encourage yourself in the Lord. I mean, the scripture was clear where it said the faith the size of a mustard seed. You can tell a mountain to jump into the sea and it's got to move. And so I believe the longer we walk with God, the longer we see God moving, like First Lady said, the longer we have those small victories, those small steps, we can actually encourage ourselves in the Lord based on the experiences we've had with him. Now, with Saul's relatively short kingship, as the scripture will continue to pour out, he still had the spirit of the Lord on him, and the people had walked with him in that year and some change to where they seen the Lord move on his behalf. And sometimes, yep, it's going to be scary. Sometimes it's going to be very fearful. Sometimes you're going to have anxiety. But if you truly are encouraging yourself in the Lord, you have to just allow your faith and patience to have its perfect work. That's all I got on that one.
Outstanding. Go ahead, Brother Dana. Go ahead.
Let me throw something in just real quick. Because dealing with fear, when I talk to people, one of the common things I hear them say is they feel bad for having fear. They feel bad for being afraid, you know. And one thing I say is, you know, I mean, that's a feeling that we really can't control. You know, it's not bad to be fearful. Yes, God, he did not give a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. And with that, you know, if you have these feelings of fear, being nervous, scared, whatever, it's allowing that feeling to stop you from acting. That's where the problem comes in. So, I mean, you can feel fear, but still move forward. You know, even if it slows you down, that's fine. You're still making some progress, you know. And so just that idea of not allowing fear to freeze you, you know, but just keep moving, and just don't stop. So
amen. If I can put a practical point on that, and I know we're leaving it, but my practical point is this: when my daughter was sentenced to death, I was fearful. I was scared. But it didn't stop me from obeying God. I couldn't let it freeze me. I couldn't let it stop me. I still had to do what God called me to do. That is my lived experience in fear. And I'm talking about the scaredest I've ever been in my entire life. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Awesome. I'm glad that we were able to get that discussion in on that fear piece, because the reality is that if all of us tell the truth this morning, and I, amen, you know, we kind of in church, so we ought to tell the truth at least, yes, today. You know, many of us, we ain't just been fearful. That's too mild for us. Some of us have been scared.
Come on.
We have been scared out of our skulls in some situations. And the reality is you have to make a, you're going to make a God decision or a man decision when fear comes on. You're either going to run and hide, or you're going to stand still and stop, freeze up, or whatever, or you're going to keep on pushing. And the thing that you, that God is looking for is, can you still push through fear to actually follow what I need for you to do? Because God himself, even if it ain't no army in front of us, sometimes God will tell us stuff that's scary. Like, man, I don't know about that one.
Amen.
But you keep pushing and you mess around and find yourself like, and the more I do it, the more I further I go, I can feel more than likely, usually I can feel that fear starting to fall off. But sometimes the fear is just with you and you just got to trust in God all the way through. And that's just real. See, we at Macedonia, we ain't trying to play church. We like, this is real church right here.
Yes, sir.
This is real church and we talking real situation. Sometimes you get scared. I've admitted to, especially to the preachers and some of our leaders, like before I preach, almost every time I preach, there's those butterflies. And everybody's like, well, Pastor, but you make it look so natural and like you ain't scared. Well, that don't mean, them butterflies don't care how I make it look.
Amen.
Them butterflies in my stomach say, yeah, you still got a little something going on. Mm. So anyway, good discussion. Let's move on to outline number two. Outline number two is Saul gives into fear. Saul gives into fear. Verse number 8-12. Verse number 8 says, and he tarried 7 days according to the set time that Samuel had appointed, but Samuel came not to Gilgal, and the people were scattered from him. And Saul said, bring hither a burnt offering to me and peace offering. And he offered the burnt offering. I'm gonna really hammer on verse number 9, because I think there's something going on in 9 that we probably, I know until I studied this time, I didn't know, but I'll come back to that in just a second. And it came to pass that as soon as he made an end of offering the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came, and Saul went out to meet him that he might salute him. And Samuel said, what hast thou done? And Saul said, because I saw the people were scattered from me, one excuse, and that thou camest not within the days appointed, two excuses, and that the Philistines gathered themselves together at Mishmash, third excuse. Therefore, I said, now watch this, man. I ain't gonna lie to you. There's something about Saul. There's a part of me that kind of like, I ain't gonna say I admire it, but I understand, because my man put this stuff together. He put it together. He's like, the Philistines will come down upon me at Gilgal, and I have not made supplication unto the Lord. Mm. So watch this. He said, I forced myself. I ain't want to do it, but I forced myself. Therefore, an offered. A burnt offering. Lord Jesus. Like, I forced myself to do wrong.
Ooh.
I did. I ain't want to do it, but I forced myself to. Verse number 8. And he tarried 7 days. Now, you'll remember, I believe it's in chapter number 10. Saul was told by Samuel, he said, now, what I need you to do, y'all, you're going to actually experience some things. The Spirit of the Lord is going to come on you, and all of a sudden you're going to be another man, and you're going to meet some prophets coming out, and you're going to prophesy, and you're going to see all these signs. And after that, he says, then I want you to go to Gilgal, and I need you to wait there 7 days till I get there. Mm. You wait 7 days till I get there, and I'm going to come, and I'm going to offer a burnt offering unto the Lord. And then I'm going to tell you what else you need to do. So that's why he's in Gilgal, because Samuel told him to go to Gilgal. What we need to understand, even if we are high titled, if you will, we still need to listen to somebody else. Lord, have mercy, Jesus. Samuel was hearing from God, and Samuel told Saul, go to Gilgal and wait. And in that instance, for that moment, he did. And it says, and Saul said, bring a burnt offering in verse number 9 to me, peace and a peace offering. And he offered the burnt offering. Here's what I want to, I share it with our panel and I'm sharing with the students. I'm going to focus a whole lot on observation and interpretation. And then I'm going to let the panel, y'all can do all three. You can do one. You can focus in on whichever one you want. In verse number 9, I have misunderstood this scripture probably my entire Christian life. Brother Dana, what I always thought and what I had been taught and what I understood in verse number 9, this is what I understood to happen. I understood that in verse number 8, Saul was supposed to be at Gilgal for 7 days. Samuel was running late, and Saul is looking at his army scattering. In other words, what happened, every single day that he waited on Samuel, some more of his army deserted him. What we're going to find in later scriptures is that he went from the 2,000 soldiers that actually followed him. By the time he got around to counting it on that seventh day, he had 600 men. So 1,400 of his 2,000, every single day, some more of them slipped off. And what I understood was that in verse number 9, he said, bring the burnt offering and the peace offering that we have prepared for Samuel to come and give an offering for. We've already got it ready for Samuel. And I understood it that Saul himself did that offering. But I've come to understand that that is not exactly what happened in verse number 9. Lord have mercy. He was talking to somebody when he said, bring me that burnt offering and bring me that peace offering. And what he did, he himself did not do an offering. He authorized it by one of the priest attendants, a guy by the name of Ahai. Lord have mercy. He wasn't supposed to do nothing with the offering, but he authorized it as if he was the priest, but he himself did not make an offering that day. But because he authorized it, and you have to be very careful. I'm going to go into an application real quick, and then I'm going to pull back. You have to be very careful how you use your authority and how you use your power.
Wow.
Ah.
Wow.
Just because you can do something don't mean you should do something. So he authorized the use of the burnt offering when he wasn't supposed to have anything to do with it. That was the priest's job. It was the priest's job all the way from Leviticus. I believe Leviticus chapter 17, I think it is. But it was the priest's job to authorize anybody or to offer the offering, the burnt offering himself. Yeah. And watch this. And it came to pass as soon as he had ended the burnt offering, behold, Samuel came. Now, many of the theologians believe that Samuel actually wasn't late. He just didn't come when Saul wanted him to. It was still on the seventh day. And sometimes we put a time frame on God when he's supposed to do something. Sometimes we put a time frame on God's people when they're supposed to do something if it doesn't fit our plan. Lord have mercy. Because it was on the seventh day, Samuel hadn't showed up. Saul authorized the burnt offering and the peace offering, and then Samuel showed up, which meant that Samuel actually showed up on the seventh day. Even if it's the 11th and 59th hour, God will actually be true to what he said he would do. Samuel was a man of God. He had heard from God. He said, you wait there 7 days till I get there. And he needed to wait the full 24 hours on the seventh day, but it appears he didn't quite wait all them 24. So now you got fear working, and probably one of the other great enemies of Christians is impatience. Lord, have mercy, Jesus.
Wow.
That is one of the worst combinations, scared and impatient. Lord, have mercy. And so we have now Samuel showing up, but Saul, I ain't gonna lie to you, man. Saul, I don't want to like glorify Saul, but it's some stuff that Saul do. I can understand it. I really can. I am not condoning it at all, but I understand it because Saul act like, man, I ain't done nothing wrong. So what Saul do, he went out to meet Samuel, and it says that he might salute him. In other words, he went out and greeted him with a blessing. Like, oh man, it's so good to see you. Bless the Lord for you. He done jacked up everything. And he go out there like ain't nothing happened. How many times do we do that?
Amen.
Woo! If somebody really didn't know, if they weren't able to hear from God when it come to us, man, they would never know we did nothing wrong, ever. Saul's like, man, don't come at me with that old yokey dope. What you do? And we need somebody in our lives, watch this, that can look beyond our veneer.
Wow.
And ask her, what did you do? What have you done? Because listen, we can fool some of the folks some of the time, but there are some people you can't fool them none of the time. They don't care how big your smile is, how good your dress or your suit is, don't care what you're presenting. Some people can look at you like, what you do? I personally know that I have some people who are with me at Macedonia. I know, and they can attest to it if they want to. I know that there have been times like they call me and we be talking. And before the conversation, like, okay, what's wrong?
Wow.
What's going on with you? I know something wrong. You ain't got to say it right now, but I know something wrong. I just don't know exactly what it is right now. Like, what's wrong? What you do? Lord have mercy.
Amen.
And many times, they will admit, but sometimes, they're like, nah, I'm good.
Wow.
Jacked up from the floor. Ooh. No, I'm good. And that's how sometimes we do. And then we find that Saul says, you were supposed to wait these appointed days. Saul said, the reason I did it was because I waited these appointed days and you were late. So it's your fault.
Wow.
Whatever's wrong with me is your fault because the Philistine was about to come down. Your fault. You were late. Your fault. And my army is deserting me every day. Wow. They scattering every day. It's your fault. It ain't my fault. He said, it's so much not my fault. I forced myself, therefore, to offer a burnt offering.
Mm.
Now, this is the last thing I'm going to say, and I'm going to hand it over to the panelists. If you can force yourself to do wrong, how come you can't force yourself to do right?
Oh, Lord.
My God. What's wrong with forcing ourselves to actually do something that is right? At this time, I want to throw it over to the panelists and see what y'all have to say about the matter.
Amen. Of course, I'll be the first to jump in and say, you know, this part spoke to me so well because I found as humans, especially those who God has blessed, and you say you got this knowledge and this brain and you're always thinking it through. You always got an answer. And for me, I'm an overthinker. And to me, that's what I can see with Saul. He's like, it don't add up. I'm looking at this. I'm looking at that. I'm looking at this. I'm adding this thing up. I'm trying to make logical sense. I mean, ain't nothing wrong with making logical sense because that's why we're created in human image. That's what we do every day. We make logical sense with our kids, with our job. And here it is, though. He's in a position where his job is not to make logical sense. And then you say, well, that don't seem right. What do you mean you're not supposed to make logical sense? That goes against human nature. Well, the truth is that even though he was in a human provided and created position as king, it really was a spiritual position that he was supposed to walk into. And we have to know the difference because sometimes I can't go off of what just makes sense logically to me. I have to make sure my spirit is aligned right with what God's will is for my life because I'm in a position where he's saying, I don't want you to go off shining at what you learned in school and what you learned through living life and experiences. I need you to go off of what I said. And that's where Saul was. He said, just do what I said, Saul. If your job is to do what Samuel said, just do what he said. And he did that to a point. And that's how sometimes we'll do. We'll do things to a point. And when it's still not adding up, like you say, he losing people and things are going wrong. He made a choice to stop, to disobey. And that's where we have to watch it as God's people. Know the difference on when you're supposed to use you. Yeah, we have spiritual discernment, everything else. Know when you're in a God-given position and you're supposed to follow what God says. You have to make sure you kind of fight that smartness. He created us so smart. I mean, we're intelligent people, but it can get in the way of an obedient believer. And I'm a living witness that it can get in the way. So we have to make sure we stay in alignment with who we're supposed to follow. So yeah, I don't care what part of my life I'm going through, I always check in on the spiritual leader. I check in with my Samuel. I check in with my Samuel because I say, you know what? I'm living in this kingdom-like world where I'm supposed to do something, but I know that my walk, no matter what my title is, has a spiritual guidance. And so I hit up my spiritual leader and say, you know what? I need you to tap into this thing with me spiritually and see what God is saying. So I really got that out of that scripture on today. So thank you.
Amen. Amen. Pastor, please let me piggyback off what my big sister in the gospel said. And I hope that the Macedonia church family, the ones that's local and the ones abroad, really, really heard what Minister Spicer said. This portion of this lesson, and actually it's been kind of the last several weeks, it is showing us that everybody, but especially people who are in positions of leadership and high responsibility, why we just don't want, but we need a pastor. I hope somebody heard what I said. We need a pastor. And here's why.
Amen.
When you are connected to the man of God, and in my case, my man of God, my big brother, my spiritual father, and my pastor, Bobby McKenzie, when I am connected to him, I can walk in my purpose and make godly decisions based off of the counsel and instruction I get from my pastor. And I don't care who you are, if you think you can go through this Christian life experience without having godly counsel and wisdom at your disposal, my dear sister and brother, you are sadly mistaken, because I know I would be tore up from the flow up and jacked up if I couldn't lean on the godly wisdom and discernment and instruction of my pastor. And let's go ahead and put it out there. If some of our national leaders actually had a Samuel, if some of our national leaders could lean on a Bobby McKenzie or a Dr. Addis Moore, I don't think that we would be having the national issues that we currently have, because they are operating like Saul operated instead of operating like the man of God needs them to operate, by being connected to source, which is our almighty heavenly Father. Amen. So Macedonia, I hope you are encouraged by what Minister Spicer said, that listen, if you can't directly connect to Pastor McKenzie, connect to somebody who is connected to Pastor McKenzie, especially when it comes to making godly decisions. All right, I'm done. I'm going to hand it over to Brother Dana. I'm a pastor rock to Brother Dana.
Yeah, I'm ready to shoot, bro. Thanks. So what I get out of this is for us to remember what God has done before. And so, and I bring that up because back in Judges chapter 7, which is before Samuel, we had a situation where Gideon had an army of 22,000 men, and God worked that down to 300. You know what I'm saying? So he reduced that down to a great number. And we see the same situation here in Samuel, you know, where Saul seeing his army just kind of dwindle down. And I don't know if Samuel had reference to, you know, that Gideon situation. I'm gonna assume that he did. But for us Christians, you know, I mean, God gave us this Bible, you know what I'm saying? And it's full of examples, wisdom, instruction. Ecclesiastes says there's nothing new under the sun. So everything that we deal with has happened before, right? And God has given us the blueprint to deal with it. And so what we have to do is we have to read this Bible. We have to study this. We have to know how to conduct ourselves in situations that arise in our lives, you know, knowing, you know, talking to each other, you know, sharing our testimonies, you know what I'm saying? How did you get through something that I'm going through right now? Mm. You know, if we just connect, commune, and just, again, just remember what God has done before, because like we say all the time, you know, if he did it before, then, you know, he'll do it again. And that trust, yeah. trust comes in knowing, you know, there's no excuse for ignorance. You know what I'm saying? I mean, we have a Bible, you know what I'm saying? So God expects us to read this Bible and just know how to conduct ourselves in any situation.
Awesome.
Pastor, and I don't know if I could be heard. I know we were having a connection issue in the other room. But the thing that I see here is we are often, as Christians, tempted to look at things like, if I obey God, then the right thing's not going to happen. So I'm forced to disobey God to make God's will come to pass. Mm. We think that we can bring about God's will by actually disobeying what God told us to do. And that is not true. God does not need us to disobey him in order to make his will work out. That's why we receive instructions like, the wrath of man does not bring about the will of God. And it's so important for us to realize this is in our personal decisions too. And I just think about when I was in 1993 and my good friends all seemed to be getting married, having children, doing their thing. I was still single. I was following God hard. And I cried out to God, like, God, I don't want to be a career woman. I want to marry and have some children. I don't feel like a career is going to be what I want. Now, if what you want for me is to be a career woman, single all my days, I'm going to want what you want, or I'm going to try real hard to want what you want. But let me tell you what I want. I want you to send me a godly husband that will lead me and love me, and we can raise some godly children together. God, that's what I'm petitioning you for. And God was kind enough to give me a prophetic word in 1993 that I would get my answer in 1996. So now let's roll into 1996. I'm dating this man. He lives in Pennsylvania. I live in Syracuse, New York. And we have been long distance dating now for like 3 years. And along comes, in January of 1996, another suitor that presents himself and is like, okay, Justine, you waiting on 1996. It's January of 1996. And that Pennsylvania brother has not proposed. So I just want you to understand that I want to be more than a friend. And it's 1996. And what I replied to that brother was, the Spirit of God is not prompting me to rush him. 1996 is a whole year. This is January. Bobby McKenzie has until December 31st at 11:59 to propose to me, or else then I'll believe that that's not who I'm waiting on. But right now in January, you might want to head on back to church, because I'm believing God all the way through to his whole word. That's what I'm going to do. Amen. And in September of 1996, that's when Bobby McKenzie proposed, and we got married in January of 97, y'all.
Amen.
I'm so happy I'm on mute. I'm always so happy I'm on mute. I'm so happy.
I'm glad you're on mute too.
That's my pastor.
Listen, the last word I'm going to say on outline number two is just going, I'm going to ask a question, but I ain't going to deal with it. How many times have we given up right as our breakthrough was about to happen? Lord have mercy. Woo! Just right as it was about to happen. How many times, if we had just waited just a little while longer? My God.
Wow.
Our last outline in these last 9 minutes, let's hit it real quick. Saul's foolish decision. Verse number 13 and 14, it says, and Samuel said to Saul, thou hast done foolishly. Thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now, with the Lord, have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever. But now thy kingdom shall not continue. The Lord has sought him a man after his own heart, and the Lord hath commanded him to be captain over his people, because thou hast not kept that which the Lord commanded thee. He did foolishly, and he lost everything. Now, let me, I want to make sure I'm clear on this, and actually I'm going to hand it right over to the panelists. Saul lost the kingdom at this time in verse number 13 of chapter number 13. He lost the kingdom right there. Spiritually, he lost it. He's in the very beginning of his kingship. Somewhere between the first and second year, no more than the second year. What we don't, may not get out of this scripture, though, is that Saul physically was on the throne just as long as David was. Saul was on the throne for 40 years. Sometimes it takes a long time for the full consequences of our actions to come to fruition. But that does not mean that he hadn't already lost the throne. His throne now wasn't a joy to him anymore. His throne wasn't with the presence of the Lord on a consistent basis. He was going to have to struggle. It's kind of like Adam and Eve. Bible says, the day that you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die. But they live hundreds of years physically later. But spiritually, there was a disconnect at that time between them and God. And there was moments of God's presence, but it wasn't a continuation, a consistent continuation, where they had the pure presence of the Lord and his benefits all the time. So then they had to work and make it was hard for them. Saul almost lost his mind, but God wouldn't let him get off the throne because he had to pay for that. At this time, this is so powerful to me. Watch this. He says, verse 14, the kingdom now, your kingdom won't continue. God has sought a man of his own heart. Remember now, remember that this is in the early portion of Saul's kingdomship.
Amen.
Watch this. What you'll find in scripture is that David, one, is the one who's after God's own heart. So God chose David right here.
Amen.
This is, I'm about to blow your mind. I'm going to tell you I'm about to blow your mind. Saul lost it right here.
Yes.
David was chosen right here.
Yes.
David wasn't even born when this happened.
Woo!
Oh, Lord have mercy. David, Saul was on the throne for 40 years. He's at most in his second year of his kingship.
Woo!
David was 23 years old when Saul died. David wasn't even born, and God chose him. My God. God is choosing us, and he's activating our birth because there is a purpose for our birth to actually be activated. Wow. And he chose David, and David wasn't even in his mother's womb. Am I talking to anybody out there?
Yes.
This is powerful stuff. He lost it.
Wow.
He lost it right here. David got it right here. David wasn't even born at this time. David wasn't anywhere on the scene. What am I trying to say? Y'all panelists, if y'all just let me take it out from here. Listen,
Pastor.
God, he's saying there are some people who will disobey their way out of their blessing and their destiny. Then there's some people will be born into their destiny. And I know who everybody is.
Lord.
And because you and I don't know who it is, our thing is just obey. When David got here, before David was out there with the sheep, God had already called his name. And so he said, that's a man after my own heart. Am I talking to anybody? You just need to know that you do the very best in your obedience because God may have actually activated your birth for such a time as this. See, I believe that God looked through the portals of time and said in 2020, as a matter of fact, 2019, a pandemic is going to come on the scene, but possibly 20, 30 years before that, he has already activated the birth of somebody so that they would be on the scene, ready to work for a Pfizer and other companies where they could be working on a vaccination or a vaccine. Amen. So that you and I would actually have the opportunity to live. See, because Amen. Without a David, we don't get a Jesus. Lord, Amen. Have mercy, Jesus.
Pastor?
Am I talking to anybody? I need somebody to understand that God, he sees us.
Yes.
And he already know. And he said that David was a man after his own heart. And watch this. Oh, how many minutes I got? Can I tell you some biblical secrets? Ooh, let me tell you. Brother Dan, I got to tell you some biblical secrets, man. I got to tell you some biblical secrets. Yeah. Watch this. Saul authorized a burnt offering and a peace offering. And he lost his throne. And when you study the book of the life of David, you will find that David did the same thing and he didn't.
Wow.
You will find that Saul wasn't the only king that acted like a priest and wasn't a priest. But when David did it, David was actually rewarded for it. So in other words, watch this. It wasn't so much that Saul authorized a burnt offering. It was that Saul did not specifically listen to the man of God's instruction at that time. Any moment of disobedience is detrimental to us. And what will be detrimental to some will actually not even harm another. And that works on the opposite side. The anointing on your life will kill somebody else. Amen. Oh, my God.
Amen.
Oh, my Amen. God. So we walk this thing out in obedience because God has a work and a destiny for us. Samuel told Saul, he said, if you had obeyed this time, your kingdom would have been established forever. But because you disobeyed, your kingdomship is gone forever. I just need God. He's basically saying, I just need you to hold the spot until I get my man on the spot. Mm-hmm. I need you to hold it down. There's some people who are holding your jobs down for you, Amen. Waiting for you to get your promotion. There's some people who are holding your blessing down. They don't want your blessings to go anywhere. They don't want your blessings to blow away. They're simply holding it in place, waiting for God to develop you and mature you, take you through all your mess, get you over your fears, get you past your impatience, get you mature enough so that then when those who are holding it, they can release it, you'll grab hope to it.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy, Jesus.
Amen.
And so, I'm sorry, panelists. We ain't got but a minute left. I was waiting to get the point, to outline number three. That was the one that got me. But we're out of time. Thank you, panelists. Thank you for joining us. Those of you, let me just give a quick word to our viewing audience.
Yes.
Every night again, I'm picking more panelists. So y'all need to pay attention to y'all email because there was some people that were supposed to be on with me today that you ain't on. And you missed one of the greatest lessons could have been. You could have been a part of all of this on screen.
Mm.
So pay attention to your emails because I should have had about four more people on this broadcast today. And you miss your blessing. Lord have mercy, Jesus. So without further ado, we thank God for each and every one of you. Brother Dana, go ahead and pray us out. We'll see everybody else at 11 a.m. sharp.
Amen. Father, we thank you so much for this, again, for this day, Lord, and this lesson that we were able to discuss. Saul's disobedience under pressure. We just pray, Lord, that everyone who was tuned in, that will tune in to the recording, will just get an understanding of how important it is to obey you, to trust you, to walk by faith, to be obedient and just live out the purpose that you called us to live in. We love you and we thank you for your instruction through your word, through our pastors and through everyone that we come in contact with, who have that spirit of God. We love you and we thank you for this day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. See y'all later. Let's have a good worship service, 11 a.m.